All right, you guys. Today's going to be a lot of fun. It's fun for me because we're going to talk about the vehicle that we've got behind me. We'll do a walk around. And this is the Overland Bound rig. It's been our vehicle since 2010, and we don't often feature it on the channel. So it's going to be fun for me to talk about it. We're going to open it up and go through it point by point. Now, take what I say today with a grain of salt. I'm going to have some opinions. I intend to have fun with this, and I'm going to say some things that are clearly an opinion. Like, for example, like the X-Wing Fighter, this vehicle is the most venerable, capable, reliable, durable vehicle in its class ever conceived, produced, and manufactured by humankind. It's perfect. Depends on what you're going to use it for. But this vehicle has been fantastic for us. And many of you guys know it was absolutely reliable until it wasn't. Last year, we had put very little money into it to keep it on the road because they're overbuilt. Dan Rich, VC Expedition on Instagram, he's been a Toyota R&D engineer for over 30 years, and he told me, he said, hey, these are way overbuilt. So we drove the heck out of it. Last year, the engine, the head gasket failed, and I rebuilt the motor. So it was extremely reliable till it wasn't, need to do some major repair, and now it's back on the road with a brand new engine. All right, let's go through this point by point. I'm also gonna say this, hey, if you guys just want the details, the data, the stats on this vehicle, well, you can go and Google that. You don't need to listen to me ramble on. If you wanna hear me ramble on about this vehicle and why it's so great, then keep watching. We'll go through it point by point and cover what I've added to the vehicle and some of the off the showroom floor stats of the vehicle. Back when I got the vehicle, I had the option to choose a couple, you know, whatever I wanted to, but I had a couple of bullet points I wanted to make sure to cover. I wanted a third row seat. I wanted it to be comfortable. I wanted it to be reliable. And I had two kids, myself, Corey, my wife, and sometimes they had their friends. So it needed to have enough seats. And I considered this vehicle and the Land Rover Disco 2 because I really liked the features of the Disco 2. If you go down the checkboxes of its on and off-road capabilities and its appointments, its features, they're very similar. However, when I really dove in, look at Edmund's true cost of ownership for the Discovery versus the Land Cruiser 80, they were extremely different. And at the time, I could find Disco 2s on used car lots all day long for $7,000, and that's because owners were unloading them because they were too expensive, the maintenance cost was too high. In contrast, the maintenance cost of the Land Cruiser 80 at the time was $500 a year. That's repairs, not oil and belts and things of that nature. That's just repair. Disco was an order of magnitude above that. So, lucky for me, I went with the 80 series FZJ80 Land Cruiser. Now I'm gonna apologize in advance for all of you guys who are out there watching the Auto Trader to try and get your 80 with the factory lockers and all the things that you want, because this video is gonna do nothing to improve your chances of finding one. At the time, I waited 3 months because I knew I wanted the front and rear locking differentials. This one has a center locking differential. In my case, I wanted it to be black and I wanted it to have under 100,000 miles on it. I bought this for $13,000. Now, you can find these features on other vehicles, but they're typically much more expensive vehicles. The G-Wagon, for example, has many of the same features, but that vehicle is six figures. So in terms of value bang for buck, this was a great purchase for us. Okay, let's start going through it. In typical walk around fashion, did I already tell you guys to take everything I say today with a grain of salt? I hope so. And feel free to disagree with me in the comments. All right, in typical walk around fashion, we're gonna start right up here at the front. I'm gonna talk about some of the things that I've changed. And although you look at the vehicle and you're like, that's a damn fine vehicle. You're saying that, right? I mean, yeah, I know. I actually haven't done that much to it. You see all the superficial stuff on the outside, but the interior is still bone stock. Not a lot of improvements on the interiors. It's worked very well. Yes, the drawer system. Parnell and I are going to get back to the drawer system in the back as soon as we are not sheltered in place and as soon as we can get together and work on it again. So fear not, you'll get an update about the drawer system. Okay, let's look right up front. This is an ARB bumper. Why? Because they are so thoroughly tested. Be cautious, you guys. If you get a bumper that looks great, it doesn't mean it's been R&D'd and tested. And sure, some of those bumpers, you look at them and you're like, no matter what, this is gonna defend me in a wreck. But the only way to have a bumper be safe without extensive R&D and testing is to overbuild it. And if you overbuild it, it's heavier than it needs to be. That's why I went with the ARB. They are all very extensively tested. And is it a pretty bumper? Is it graceful? Is it, does it have the shark's teeth on the front of it and all that stuff? No, it doesn't. Does it have aluminum crumple points on the tips and steel? No, it's just a very well built utilitarian bumper. That's why I went with it. Okay, now my winch arguably is underpowered, but for those of you guys wondering, the M8000 worn winch has been just fine for me. It has never been underpowered in any situation I have ever had the vehicle in. However, if you're gonna be in mud a lot, that 8,000 pounds, given the 6,000 some odd pound vehicle, is gonna be underpowered for pulling you out of mud when you have a lot of resistance. Then what you'll have to do is you'll have to use a snatch block, double up your winch line to get twice the pull power, and you'll be fine. That winch has been great. Now up front, I used to have the Hella Rally 4000 lights. I switched over to the KCs because they're LED, they draw much less power, there's less of a burn, they generate, you know, much less heat. I don't know, you guys saw, if you guys have followed me for a little while, one time my knee bumped the Hella switch and the Hella lights on my rack stayed on all day. I came back and the covers, the light covers were melted off the front of my spotlights and the battery was absolutely dead. And if you are thinking, if you're over there being holier than thou, thinking that was not a very bright move, you're right. I learned from it. Anyway, so LED lights, and further on the front, I will say that right now you see that closed shackle system on the front. I'm gonna change that back to the hook and leave the closed shackle in the rig. Here's why, because when you're in a hurry, a closed shackle system slows you down. And if you just need to throw a hook on something and keep it from rolling over the side or off a cliff, you can throw a hook on just about anything. The closed shackle system is great if you have time for a cup of tea. So I'm gonna actually switch that out, but I really do like the closed shackle system. It's much safer. You just need time to use it. That's why I'm gonna switch that out. Okay, what else we got up front? We got the ham radio antennas. A lot of folks ask me, why are they up front? Well, you don't need a grounding plane for this kind of antenna. And it's a clear view out in front, and you don't see them after about 5 days of driving this way. You don't see the antennas in front of you. And the CB antenna acts as a height indicator. If the tip of the CB antenna hits anything, I know I don't fit. Okay, I've got the hood open. It is a 4.5 liter inline six cylinder tractor motor is what I would call it. It is perfectly powered for what I'm asking the engine to do. It doesn't get good gas mileage. I get 11 to 13 miles per gallon no matter what, whether I'm loaded or unloaded. That's just what I get. So gas, fuel is expensive. I'm considering upgrading to a long ranger gas tank or some other 40 gallon gas tank solution, which would go underneath the vehicle where the spare tire used to be, but that isn't done yet. But the engine itself, now again, this is a 4.5 liter FZJ 80. The engine is larger than the earlier models, like the 92, for example. Those were underpowered. This vehicle with 35s, with the power button, it's got a little power button, which changes the shift gate points, a power button, always on is not underpowered. I never, when I put the 35s on it, I didn't feel the difference, quite honestly. That is not the case for the earlier model. Let's talk about the tires. I have the BFGoodrich KM3 Mud Terrain 315 75R 16 tires. Another amazing thing about the 80, you can lift it up 2.5 inches, stuff 35s underneath it, no tire rubbing whatsoever. It's one of the few vehicles that you can do that with. So it's got the 35s, called 35s, they're actually 34 3/4, underneath the wheel well, stuffed under there, and they work absolutely fantastic. For most people, I think I would recommend the all-terrain, the BF Goodrich KO2s. Wouldn't recommend any other tire because, well, we don't use them. I've used BF Goodrich tires for decades. I used to be a general contractor. My construction truck had BF Goodrich tires on it. My family truck had KO2 tires on it. No, BF Goodrich is not paying me to say any of this stuff. I run BF Goodrich tires on my trucks, and that's it. They've been great. And for the record, yes, you can run them aired down from Cabo San Lucas to San Francisco. Ask me how I know. Or better yet, don't ask me how I know. Okay, so we covered the engine, we covered the tires, we covered the bumper, we covered the lights, we covered the couple of antennas that are up there. These are called limb risers. They're called limb risers because they're for hanging your swim trunks. They're called limb risers because that's exactly what they're for, and they do a very good job. In another past life, I also used to work for my family's logging company, and all of the bulldozers had limb risers on them, but they were pipes that were this big around, and they ran from the front to keep trees from going through the cab. This does the same thing at a smaller diameter. You can actually hit a large branch at a fairly high rate of speed, and it's gonna knock it out of the way instead of bashing a windshield or ripping off your lights or doing some other things. Okay, another note, this thing here, this ribbon down here, that's to keep your fingers away from the hook or the closed shackle system. It's to keep your fingers anywhere near any of the rolly parts on the winch. You can bump a winch if your friend isn't careful, you bump a winch, it'll take your arm off if you get it caught. So this is so you never get your hands anywhere near the movie parts. Okay, now underneath here, I have a fuse and relay block for all of my accessories. Now, if I push one button, one great big waterproof 100 amp breaker, the vehicle goes back to bone stock wiring. It cuts everything off. All of my accessories, my refrigerator, my 1500 watt inverter, my all the things are cut off by that one breaker. So if anything should happen, if I should smell smoke, if my lights should flicker, if anything funky happens whatsoever, I know if I hit that button, it's gonna go back to factory stock and we should be good. I can then diagnose. The relay fuse block that I've created is not an S-Pod. I don't like S-Pod. I don't like Switch Pros. Sorry, guys. Here's why. Because we have 25,000 members worldwide, and they report those things failing. And until the solid-state gear gets extremely reliable, I'm not into those types of systems. Yes, it makes your wiring less complicated. Yes, it makes accessories easy to hook up, but I hear about them failing time and time again. So I am simple, fuses and relays. I bring spare relays and I bring spare fuses, and it's easy for me to diagnose. Now the switch pods and the switch pros and the S pods, switch pods and the S pros, they they do have relay and fuse systems, and there are other relay and fuse systems out there that are not solid state. I'd be fine with that so long as I can maintain it. But I created my own box back there for all of my accessories. Okay, now moving out from underneath the hood, going around the vehicle, the sliders. I always tell people, they ask me, I'm new to overlanding, I'm just now building up a rig, what should I focus on next? I've got Hanna quality sliders on the side. I always tell people, build from the ground up. So it is tires, sliders, lift, or if you're gonna go oversize with your tires, it is probably lift tires, sliders. But one of those three things. You want sliders because the first thing you're going to do when you get out there on the trail is you're going to frickin' center bash, high center on your breakover angle, which is the angle at which your vehicle starts to teeter because there's a rock up underneath it between your front and rear tires. And that's an expensive repair. You're going to do it right away. They're called sliders because you slide on rocks, and you're going to do it all the time. You get on the trail, and you look, and you're navigating. And you're like, okay, I'm going to put my slider right on that rock, and I'm going to slide down it until you guys that don't want to scratch your rigs, forget about it. You're going to scratch your rigs. Don't worry about it. You're going to scratch your wheels. I rattle can my wheels. I hit it with a spray with a rattle can about once a year because I'm just going to beat them up. You're going to scratch your rig. What it sounds like, just so you know, the way it should sound when you rest your slider on a rock and you slide down, it should sound like this. Let's cover the roof rack. My roof rack is a Gobi. It's a Gobi Ranger rack. The stealth racks are cool, and they might let you get into your garage, but they don't have the high sides, and I like the high sides for strapping things down, for having a little bit more lateral support to things which you're trying to contain on the inside. I have the Ranger rack as opposed to the stealth rack. The Ranger rack also fits the larger lights better, and I like the larger lights. Here's the thing about Gobi. They can't get you your rack. They cannot tell you when your rack is going to ship to you. They can't, right? Would I have gotten another rack had I known that they have no idea when your rack is going to get to you? Yes, I still would have gotten the Gobi rack. That's the deal. And that's what I tell everybody is get a Gobi rack. They're really cool. But if you need a Gobi rack for a specific trip that's coming up, it's not going to happen because they take anywhere from, I don't know, 8 months to a year plus, and they're nice, but they're going to tell you it's going to be 8 weeks, and it's not going to be 8 weeks. So know that about the Gobi rack, but also know they're extremely high quality. They're very good racks, and I'm glad I have it. I can walk up there all day long. It's got a nice mesh on the top. I've had it since 2010, and there's been no issues with it whatsoever. I'll have it for another 10 years. So that's 20 years of roof rack. It's a really good, solid piece of kit. Oh, and it's not modular. You guys getting the modular stuff out there. People are like, well, no, but modular stuff, it's really come a long way. It's really durable. And, those fasteners, it's like 80-20. If it's in pieces, it's just one more thing that's going to break, come apart, rattle loose. I hate rattles. This is a one-piece design. It's a one-piece design. It'll never rattle. Solid piece of kit. All right. Shovel and axe, of course. Now, let's talk about that rear swing out. See, now, the rear swing out, people ask me about it all the time. It is Hanna quality. As far as I know, you can't really get them anymore. And never met the owner of Hanna Quality. I have one of his products. He's a really nice guy, but I can't even refer people because I don't know if he makes them now or not. I don't think it's not a high volume piece of equipment. So if 100 people want a Hanna quality dual swing out 80 series rear bumper, it's not going to be available. So unfortunately, I would recommend the kit all day long. The rear bumper is absolutely fantastic, but I don't know that you can get one. It's killer. Underneath the armor plating, I mean, that must be all near quarter inch thick steel underneath there. The 80 series has a not so great departure angle, but I've got that Hanna quality bumper on the rear. I just drag the butt down the rocks and it is fine. There have been two vehicles that have totaled themselves on the back of my 80 series. I do not have a scratch. I'm serious about that. Not a scratch. Accident. I get out of the truck. Are you okay? I'm not gonna call you. You good? You're safe. Okay, have a nice day. It is a very durable piece of kit. Okay, I'm gonna switch around. We're gonna talk about the rear of the vehicle. We're gonna take that angle for a second. All right, talking a little bit more about the kit from this perspective, finishing up with the Hanna Quality rear bumper. You can see it houses the high lift jack here, a full size spare. Got to get that out from underneath. Now, you guys might notice, I've got my MaxTrax ratcheted to the outside of the tire. I don't have a trasheroo on here because I'm sick of creating landfill. I've been through 4 trasheroos before I switched. They're not very good. The trash carrier that I have right now is called Ghost Wild. They last a really long time, but they also don't have their production figured out, so you can't get one. If anybody knows a good trash character, I know that there's Blue Ridge, but if anybody knows a good trash carrier, glad to hear about it and share with our members and the community watching down in the comments. Okay, so why do I strap the MaxTrax on the rear tire? Because I flip this ratchet strap, I pull it off, and I'm good to go. I used to have it mounted on the side of the Gobi rack, but the thing about that is, when it's super cold and you're in the snow, it's a pain to get that off. Your hands are frozen. Here, I just take that strap off and the MaxTrax are readily available. Now, for those of you guys out there going, sure would be nice to see that walk around out on the trail. You guys probably don't even go out on the trail. I wish I were on the trail too, but we're not. We're sheltering in place because we're doing our part and it's making a difference. So good job, you guys. All right, here we are in my driveway. We're talking about this further. Let's talk about this nice piece of kit here. Wow. Aww. This is awesome. This is by Back Bay Customs, and it makes the tailgate space usable. You'd be amazed at what you can fit in this space. You just gotta warn people that you have all this stuff in here, because when they go to drop the tailgate, I can't tell you how many times I've heard, bam, because it weighs a lot when you put all this kit in here. But I put some recovery equipment in here. I put tire repair in here. I put the Fieldcraft Survival Trauma Kit in here, which is very compact so that it's always very readily available. And then I've got the Overland Bound Med Kit on the inside of the rig that has more kit in it. Okay, water break. Water break. New camera battery. Bunch of things. Airplane. All right, I hear my friend the internet out there, you know, taking a look at this, and once you guys go and see the price for this storage system, you're gonna say, hey, I could build that for much less expensive, collect the stuff, cut it out myself, get the different brackets and the gas struts and the trim that goes around the, you could, you're right, yep. Now, for me, it was worth it to support a small business that's put a lot of time and attention into the creation of this unit. I mean, the hardware is great. This locking this locking mechanism here, the proper size gas strut, and you know, like I said, this when you cut this hole in your tailgate, there's a rough edge here. They provide the trim pieces, so it really turns it into a quick job. So to me, that was definitely worth it to do it. Okay. Okay, now another thing, you guys remember I said I had the 12 volt accessory power to that one single 100 amp breaker up front. Well, from that, there's a 4 gauge umbilical power that comes out the back. It's as big around as my pinky, and that comes to this power block. And the power block does a couple of things. It provides 12 volt accessory power for the refrigerator and other things when we bring the refrigerator. And I have 110 pure sine wave, 110 volt pure sine wave inverter back here from Wagon Tech. Wagon Tech is great, check them out. And pure sine wave, so I can power sensitive equipment. I don't have to worry about dirty or surging power, so I can plug a laptop in there, no problem. Camera equipment in there, no problem. So it's a pure sine wave inverter. Now, when I have the drawer system in here, I'm gonna have this be flush mount facing the back. It'll be even more convenient. There's also a nice voltmeter there, so I can see where my battery power is. Now, Dometic fridges, they shut themselves off so they won't kill your battery. They keep your starter power, so they do that automatically, which is a great thing. Okay, I got my kicker speaker back here, so I go boom while I'm going down the trail. It's a low profile speaker. I like it. Again, my sand grabba mats protect the interior from mud and liquid. And then we've got our kit is pretty darn basic. You know, we got the camping box here, or we got the kitchen box here. That's our sleeping box. We've got, you know, I just got my duffel back here, tools, various other things, the larger trauma kit, Overland Bound trauma kit back here as well. Now, the thing I'll mention is that when those seats go forward, the back space back here is perfectly flat. So you can put sleeping pads back here. It's been very convenient, especially in cold weather. It's perfectly flat. There's no dips in the floor. So again, you can sleep back here, no problem. Okay, I wanna show one other thing to you, and that's how this 12 volt pump and faucet works. I just did a how-to video just a few days ago. You guys can go and see how you can put a 12 volt pump and faucet on a 5 gallon water container. That prevents me from having to pull out this container to access the water. It's super convenient. All right, so since I did the video, I haven't had a chance to, you know, bundle and wrap all these waters. I'll make sure it's protected from the elements, and then I'll route the wires so that they're much cleaner. But for now, I just have this cigarette lighter adapter that goes into my power block, and I'll show you how this works. Now, if you guys have the theme song for the Beverly Hillbillies playing in your head right now, that's about right. All right, but check this out. Pretty darn cool, right? Anyway, check out that video. It's a few days ago. If you guys want to build something like this yourself, you can. All right, that's about it. You guys can see that this area of the rig, when we go someplace, those of you guys that don't like rig, they're like, don't refer to your 80 series as a rig, because that's a truck. No, it's not a truck. It happens to be a truck. It also happens to be, we used to, you know, when I was logging, family logging company, when I was logging the yarder up on the hillside that pulled up the logs, we referred to that as the rig. The trucks had rigging. My town, it was fishing or logging, that was it. And the commercial fishing boats, they had rigging on the boat. There's oil rigging. So really, rig. It's just, there's a lot of rigging on this vehicle, so I just refer to it as the rig. That's it. Rig, 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 rig. Okay, I think that's about it. Let's continue our tour. All right, you guys, now on the front here, like I said, the interior is pretty much bone stock, but I'm gonna point out a few things because we have put some effort into our comms choices and power, things of that nature. All right, so you guys know that I have the Kenwood ham radio. I did an install video just a couple of days ago. You guys can go back and look at that. There's also in the description, you can see why I chose the Kenwood over the Yaesu. Had some great advice from Brian. He's our Southwest Overland Bound ambassador. So I've got the Kenwood, a couple of things for it, 50 watt radio, acts as a crossband repeater. So if you've got little handheld, you can use a vehicle as, you know, a repeater for the lower power handhelds. It's got APRS and a lot of other fantastic features. You might see the DeLorme. The DeLorme is not part of the vehicle, but it's always in the vehicle. That is satellite comm. So if you don't have cell service and you do get yourself in a sticky situation, it's two-way communication via the satellite network. As long as you can see the sky, you can send out a text message or receive text messages. There are no blackout areas anywhere on the planet. So that's the DeLorme InReach. I have a GMRS radio. I still have a CB radio, and I have the ham. The reason I have all three forms of communication is because you don't know what other people are going to have on the trail. You want to be able to communicate. For the ham radio, because that's my primary radio now, KM6 YSL, thank you, I have the external speaker on the that is just behind the driver's head, so that if you're on the trail, you're rattling down the trail, you'll be able to hear that ham radio loud and clear, and it's separate from your car stereo equipment, which is always kludgy and cumbersome. Other than that, There are blanks, switch blanks that come from the factory. I've replaced the switch blanks with actual switches, and that is a power to a small 110 watt inverter in the front, and it is power to a rear light that I have that is a rear scene light, and I have a couple of accessory switches that I don't need. I also, or that are not currently wired up. I also have switches for the spotlights on the bumper, the floodlights on the bumper, and the spotlights on above on the roof rack, two separate. And then you guys are gonna see the diff lock switch. That's just what it came with from the factory. As I said, front and rear locking differentials. When this thing is fully locked, meaning the front differential is locked and the rear differential is locked. Then this thing is like a tank. It's like a billy goat. Oh, for those of you that don't like the term fully locked, fully locked. All right, I think that is just about it. Is there anything else in here? No magnet for my light and RAM mounts. These are the only mounts that I've found that will mount to your window and not come off. They do come off with a extreme temperature differential, but other than that, these are super secure. Okay, sand grabber mats in the middle row, and that is that for the interior. Okay, let's talk about a couple of features up front on this side here. Oh, you'll notice I didn't wash my truck for this video. A couple of features up front on this side. This is a safari snorkel. Now, why do you need a safari snorkel? A lot of you guys, you know the answer to this, but some people may not. It is cold air, clean air, and finally, to have your air intake above water and dust and things of that nature. Now, in this vehicle, the air box is already about this high, and my vehicle starts to float in a stream when the water is this high. So do you really need it for water crossing? It helps, but you also have to make sure that you vent the differentials, vent the transmission, and have the diff breathers that come up higher than the water level as well. So you gotta do a bunch of things right before you can depend on this for a deep water crossing and still keep your vehicle in good shape. The other accessory I'm gonna mention is two other accessories. One, we have this Overland Pros 270 degree awning, and the awning is good, light duty use, and it's not expensive. So what that means is it's around $300 and some odd, whereas the AluCab is, you know, $1,800. But the AluCab is a one-hand, one-minute assembly job, and you don't have to, well, you don't have to do any assembly, you just unfold it. This, you do some assembly, you have to put the legs down and you have to tie it off, and it's got a lot of good things going for it, primarily the cost, but it is more cumbersome than the AluCab or something of that nature. And the final and most important accessory I'm going to talk about, it adds additional horsepower, it increases your gas mileage, increases reliability, will extend the life of your vehicle for over 5 years beyond what is expected from the factory. In terms of the total mileage, it will increase the mileage on your engine from 200,000, say, to 300,000. It does all of those things, and that is the Overland Bound membership and emblem. It should be a factory accessory, but it's not, but you can get one. Consider becoming an Overland Bound member in all seriousness. Consider becoming an Overland Bound member. There are 25,000 of us worldwide. It is a community of adventure travelers that wants to help you understand what you need to know to outfit and explore and go out on the trail. Right now we are sheltering in place, so our adventures are waiting. They're on hold, but we are busy planning the next great adventure. We have an awesome community. There's great software, off-road, off-grid event software, trail resources and maps and forums, all kinds of good stuff. So please go over to our website, check it out. There'll be a link in the description, but just go to overlandbound.com. We are Overland Bound everywhere. You guys, thank you for sharing today with me. This has been a lot of fun. Like I said, I don't talk about the 80 all that frequently, so it's been fun to share it with you guys today. All right, we'll have another video tomorrow because that's what we are doing. While you guys are sheltering in place, we're trying to do a video a day. We're thinking about you. We hope to see you on the trail soon. You guys take care and be safe.